Hey guys, I'm Paul Rabelais here. I'm a Louisiana estate planning attorney. I want to go over a situation that I've been involved in several times over the years. What happens when a person dies, let's call it a gentleman dies, and he has no will, no spouse, no kids, no surviving parents, and he owns some stuff when he died? What happens? Well, it kind of causes the family to go into a tether, especially when the death is unexpected. So let's go through what happened. First, who are the heirs? Well, since the person died and he didn't have any kids or grandkids and he didn't have a spouse and didn't have any surviving parents, but he had some siblings, let's say he had six siblings, then his siblings are his heirs. And in the case where any of those siblings had predeceased or died before him, then that sibling's children would represent the deceased sibling. So all that's fine and dandy. That's kind of Louisiana bar exam 101. So, who are the heirs? But really what I wanted to get to is how do they get it? And what's the procedure? And what's everybody go through? Got to go through. So first we'll talk about how, I usually have a conversation with the family and the family typically picks one, could be two co-administrators, but let's say for purposes of this video, the family selects one of those siblings to be appointed as the administrator of the succession of the deceased. When someone has a will, they'll name an executor, but when someone doesn't have a will, then an administrator has to step up and a judge appoints someone to be appointed as the administrator to handle stuff while all this is going on. So we want to make sure that whoever that administrator is qualifies as what's called an independent administrator. Less court supervision will be necessary. There's still a court proceeding necessary, but if the administrator is independent, then if that administrator needs to pay a light bill on the deceased's home or pay a credit card bill, well, that independent administrator won't have to get a judge to approve every act. They'll be able to take some action without a judge's approval. But all of the heirs, all of those surviving siblings, all of the children of the deceased siblings will have to sign off on the paperwork petitioning the court to appoint an independent administrator. Real important there. If someone's not an independent administrator and they're just an administrator, it's a mess and it's a hassle, particularly if the deceased owned any real estate that needs to be sold. All right, so bunch of paperwork, court pleadings get prepared. We file all that at the proper parish courthouse where the person was domiciled, and hopefully a judge does sign all the court orders necessary to appoint that person as the independent administrator. What's next? Typically, everyone's different, but every succession is different. But typically the next step is that independent administrator will open an estate account. Perhaps we obtained a tax ID number for the estate from the IRS. The independent administrator will open an estate account, and the independent administrator will have the appropriate court paperwork so that any banks that have the deceased person's funds, which will be frozen, the independent administrator's court paperwork will require that those banks sitting on frozen accounts will turn that money over to the independent administrator, and all that money will flow into typically an estate account at a bank that the independent administrator chooses. Now perhaps it's time to sell the deceased's home and vehicles, so once the judge appoints the appropriate person as the independent administrator, they'll have the authority to sell the house, sell the vehicles. All that money from the proceeds of those sales will go into the estate account. In the meantime, us lawyers are preparing inventories of assets, detailed descriptive lists of assets and liabilities is what it's often called. We got to show, a judge and show the court, what the person owned, what the person owed, so they can supervise the distribution of it. And then finally, at the end, once kind of everybody's assured that all of the deceased's debts have been paid, any estate debts have been paid, a judge will then sign what's called a judgment of possession, an order ordering that estate assets be divided up in the proper proportions among those heirs. So if there were six siblings, each sibling would get 1/6, but the children of the deceased siblings would would also share in 1/6. So that all would get down. Okay, so that's in short what would happen. A few comments that are important. Maybe it would have been appropriate to do what's called a small succession affidavit in a matter like this. And when a person dies, they lived in Louisiana, they had no will, they had less than $125,000 of assets. There is a simpler procedure called a small succession affidavit that we sometimes utilize. In our example, I didn't feel it was appropriate because I felt like it was appropriate for an administrator to be appointed, pool all those monies together in an estate account, pay the debts that need to be paid, and then divide up the balance after all the expenses and debts have been paid, divide up the balance among the heirs. When you have a small succession affidavit procedure, you don't get an opportunity for one person to collect the funds, sell assets. It's maybe appropriate when you have one bank account and it just needs to be divided three ways and there are no debts. Then sometimes that small succession affidavit is appropriate. So you need to talk to your, you know, Louisiana estate lawyer to figure out what's the most appropriate procedure to take when settling an estate. But that small succession affidavit procedure only even permitted when a person had no will and they had less than $125,000 of assets. Also permitted, by the way, if they had no will and they died more than 20 years ago. It should be called the small or old succession affidavit procedure. All right, couple of other comments. Perhaps if the deceased should have done something before he died, among many things, he could have written a will, named an executor who's gonna hire the lawyers, guide the family through the court process, name the heirs. You know, maybe he didn't want it all to go to his siblings equally, so he could have, in his will, written where he wanted it to go. That would tell a judge who to make sure the assets get dispersed to. If he would have wanted to take an extra step to make things even simpler for his heirs in the future, perhaps he would have set up what's commonly referred to as a revocable living trust. He would have named the successor trustee to handle his trust when he died, and he would have named the beneficiaries of his trust to receive the assets when he died. Trust assets don't have to go through any court-supervised settlement. That trustee, kind of almost the day after the gentleman dies, can start that process of dispersing the assets out of the trust without the typical court and attorney involvement that's required when you have a succession. Maybe one more comment that's appropriate. Real important that this independent administration happen, which requires all of the heirs to sign off on that. Because if you don't have independent administration and you just have an administration, then, oh my goodness, so much more bureaucratic and paperwork and red tape needed to, for example, sell the home of the deceased. Lots of advertising in newspapers, lots of court filings, lots of judicial approval. It's a mess. Want to avoid it if you can. So there you have it. Just a scenario, no will, no spouse, no kids. Really no problem as long as all of the heirs are cooperative and supportive and are all on board of the plan to get things done. Hope that helps. Can be complicated. What I want you to do, if you have some experiences, feel free to comment, you know, like, share, whatever you can do to help spread the word. I'm Paul Rambla. You have a great day.